Welcome to this class, which is about instruments of credit in a business, especially the bills of exchange. The business transactions are not always on cash basis. The safest way for a seller is to sell his goods on cash basis, deliver the goods and receive the cash. No risk is involved in that. But that is not the business practice. A business or a company or a firm has to follow the business practice, which is to provide the goods or to supply the goods and services on credit basis. So there is always a risk for the seller of these goods or seller of the services. The risk is default by the purchaser. The purchaser of these goods or services may not pay on the agreed date for the goods or services which he has received from the seller. So the instrument of credit comes into picture. Instrument of credit is a written instrument which is a proof that credit is given to the purchaser and he has to pay a certain amount in a future date. Now, what could be these instruments of credit? Instruments of credit are normally two. One is promissory note and second is bill of exchange. Both are classified as instruments of credit. A promissory note is made by the purchaser who is obliged to pay the amount at a future date. It is a promise by him. He writes on a paper that he promises to pay a certain amount of money at a certain date or on demand to the seller of the goods or services in future. So promissory note is prepared by whom? Promissory note is always prepared by the purchaser, who is a debtor in this case. In sell purchase transactions, two parties are involved. One is seller or the creditor who gives the credit, and second is the purchaser who is a debtor who has to pay the amount in the future. So a promissory note is prepared by the debtor or the purchaser of the goods, and it is an unconditional commitment on the part of the purchaser to pay a certain amount on a certain date or on demand to the seller of the goods. Now, what is a bill of exchange? Bill of exchange is always prepared by the creditor or the seller of the goods. He has to receive the money, but he prepares an instrument saying, he is called the drawer of this instrument. He makes the instrument, so he is the drawer of the instrument. He signs it. He writes on that piece of paper, please pay rupees so and so, so many days after this date to me or my order. So what is mentioned in a bill of exchange? The amount is mentioned in a bill of exchange. It is drawn on the party, on the purchaser, who is the drawee of the bill. Seller is the drawer of the bill. He writes to Mr. B, who is the purchaser of the good, that pay so much amount. Amount is mentioned there. Period is mentioned, pay so many days after this to me or my order. Means you pay either to me or to whomsoever I order. And he signs this. Now, who keeps these bills of exchange and promissory note? All these instruments of credit are held by whom? Logically, only the seller who has to receive the money, he will be keeping these. What is the use of the credit instrument? It is first a proof of the credit provided, and second, it is a legal instrument. In case of default, the seller has got a legal recourse against the purchaser. He can go to the court and say that this is the instrument which shows that I have given credit to this debtor and I have to receive this money. He is liable to pay so much money to me. So instrument of credit is always held by the seller or creditor. In case of a promissory note, because it is signed by the debtor, he is the drawer of this, he is the maker of this, he says I promise to pay you. So if the seller retains this instrument, that is sufficient. Only the signature of the debtor or the purchaser of goods are necessary. But in a bill of exchange, it is prepared by the creditor or the seller of the goods, only his signatures are there. So if he retains this with him, it has got no legal value because it is prepared by him, it is signed by him. It is only an order to the purchaser to pay a certain amount in future. So this has got no legal value. It has to be accepted by the purchaser. Unless he accepts it, purchaser writes on the back of it or somewhere that he is accepting this bill of exchange. Then only it becomes a bill of exchange and it has got legal validity. So what are the qualities of a bill of exchange? It's a bill in writing. It is made and signed by the creditor, who is called the drawer of this bill. Purchaser is called the drawee of the bill. It is an unconditional order to pay a certain sum of money in future to the drawer or his order. Now, what is the distinction between a promissory note and a bill of exchange? Both are instruments of credit, but there is a difference between the two. There are similarities and there are differences also. Similarity is that both require stamping. Stamp duty is to be paid on promissory note as also on the bill of exchange. Now the differences between the two are, number first difference, the basic difference is promissory note is prepared by the debtor or purchaser of good, whereas a bill of exchange is prepared by the creditor or seller of the goods. He is the drawer of the bill. A promissory note is a promise to pay in future. Promise is made by the purchaser of the goods. A bill of exchange is made by the creditor. It is an order to the purchaser to pay a certain amount of money in the future. Now, second difference between the two is that promissory note does not require any acceptance. It is valid without any signature of the seller or creditor, whereas a bill of exchange requires acceptance of the purchaser or drawee of the bill, then only it becomes a legal instrument. Another difference between the promissory note and a bill of exchange is that when a promissory note is dishonored, means the purchaser of the good does not pay the amount on the due date or in future whenever it is false due, it need not be noted. I'll tell you what noting is. Whereas in case of a bill of exchange, it is necessary that a bill of exchange, when it is dishonored or not paid on due date, it should be noted. Noting means you have to go to the notary public and notarize there that this amount has not been paid, the bill is dishonored. That is called noting of the bill. In case of promissory note, it is not necessary, whereas in case of a bill of exchange, it is a necessary requirement. Now let us take another instrument, which is check. Check is often used in business. I am purchasing certain goods and I am issuing a check. So what is a check? Is it a promissory note or is it a bill of exchange? A check is in fact a bill of exchange. But there are certain differences between the bill of exchange and a check. First difference is that a check need not be stamped. No stamp duty is required for issuing a check. You can just sign it and issue it to the payee. Whereas in case of a bill of exchange, you require stamp duty as per the law. You have to pay the stamp duty, put the stamps on the bill of exchange. Then only it becomes a legal instrument. Also, second difference is now A bill of exchange requires acceptance. Without acceptance of the purchaser or drawee, a bill of exchange has got no legal validity. In case of a check, this acceptance is not necessary. You just issue the check. It is a legal instrument. If it is dishonored, legal action can be taken against you. Now, there is another difference between a check and a bill of exchange. A check is always drawn on a specific banker, whereas a bill of exchange can be drawn on any person. Means the amount is to be paid as per bill of exchange by the person who is on whom the bill of exchange is drawn. The check is a bill of exchange drawn on a specific banker. Second thing is, a check is payable on demand. The person to whom the check is issued, he can go to the bank any time and get the check encashed or credited to his account. Whereas in a bill of exchange, a period is given after which the amount becomes payable. Let me explain this period, which is mentioned in a bill of exchange. This is mentioned by the drawer that pay so much amount after so many days or so many months. This period is called the tenor or tenure of the bill. And what is the due date? As per law, 3 days grace period is allowed. So if on 1st January, if you have drawn a bill payable after 3 months from the date of the bill, then logically it should be paid on 1st April because 3 months lapse on 1st of April. But as per law, 3 days grace period is allowed to the purchaser or debtor for payment of this bill of exchange. So it becomes payable on 4th of April. So 4th of April is the due date of the bill. Whereas in case of a check, there is nothing like due date. It is issued today. It immediately becomes payable. If he goes to the banker after 5 minutes, he will get the payment of that. So that is one difference between the two. About the due date, let me explain a very valid point here. That due date of the bill, as I explained, it is period mentioned in the bill plus 3 days of grace period. The example which I took, 4th April becomes the due date of the bill. What happens if 4th April is a holiday? 4th April becomes a holiday, so it cannot be paid on 4th of April. Logically, we will think that it should be payable on 5th of April, but law says no, it is payable on 3rd of April, the previous working day. If 3rd is also a holiday, it is payable on the 2nd of April. So if the due date falls on a holiday, the bill becomes payable on the earlier working day, not the next working day. On earlier working day, it becomes payable. So as I said, there is no due date in case of a check, but in case of a bill of exchange, there is always a due date, which is period mentioned in the bill, tenor of the bill, plus 3 days of grace period. Now, there are certain terms associated with a bill of exchange. Now, we will be confining ourselves to the bill of exchange. We have understood what is the difference between check and a bill of exchange, what is the difference between a promissory note and a bill of exchange. So let us familiarize ourselves with certain terms associated with a bill of exchange. One of the important terms of a bill of exchange is holder in due course. Suppose your bill of exchange is lost. Seller prepared this, he signed it as a drawer, it was accepted by the drawee, who is purchaser of the goods, and it was given to the seller or creditor, he kept it in his custody. Suppose he loses it, he lost it or it is stolen. So whether the person who has got it or who has stolen it, does he become a holder in due course? No. He is not entitled to get the payment of this bill on the due date. He is not a holder in due course. He can become a holder in due course only if it is endorsed by the drawee. If Mr. A, who has drawn the bill, who has sold the goods, if he writes that I endorse it to C, He says, now pay it not to me, but to my order, which is Mr. B. Then B becomes the holder in due course. So to become a holder in due course, there should be a transaction and it should be endorsed for a consideration. If there is a consideration and it is endorsed by the drawer of the bill or payee of the bill, then he becomes the person who holds it, becomes a holder in due course. Now the major advantage of a bill of exchange or this instrument of credit is that it can be negotiated by the bank and amount can be immediately given to the drawee. So the person who has sold the goods on credit, he is not out of the funds. He has raised the bill, it is accepted by the drawee or purchaser of the goods and it is given to the bank for discounting or negotiation. Suppose the bill is for 10,000 rupees, bank will give him an amount of say 9,700, deducting 300 rupees towards the discount, because bank will not be giving 10,000, it will receive money only on the due date. From the purchaser of the goods, bank will receive money only on the due date. So bank is extending credit for the tenor of this bill, so for that bank will be charging the interest on the funds plus other charges. So discount amount is involved. Bank will be paying 9,700 instead of 10,000 rupees, which is amount of the bill. But bill can be discounted by the bank. Bill can also be sent for collection. If the drawee is in some other city, bill can be given to the bank with the instruction that you send it to that city and on due date you present it to the drawee. So it goes to the bank branch, that bank's branch in that particular city. They keep it and on due date they present it to the drawee who pays the bill. That is called collection of the bill. Another term associated with a bill of exchange is honoring of the bill. If the bill is paid on the due date, that is called honoring the bill. If it is not paid on the due date, then that becomes a dishonor of the bill. What is retirement of the bill? Retirement of the bill is paying on the due date, that is called retirement of the bill. Now what happens in case of dishonor of a bill of exchange? There is a notary public involved in this. Notary public means one who is authorized by law to notify this type of things. This is called also protesting. You protest the bill, means it has not been paid. You go to the notary public, you get the notification of that, you notarize that, and that is called protest or notification, noting the bill. What happens to the charges? Some charges are to be paid to the notary public. These charges will ultimately be recovered from whom? From the drawee, who was supposed to pay on the due date, but he has not paid. So these charges will be recovered either by this drawer or by the bank who has discounted the bills. They will be paying this. These are certain terms involved in bill of exchange. Another point I will take here is about the accommodation bills. A bill of exchange originates from a genuine trade transaction. There is sale of goods, there is purchase of goods or any services or any other consideration is there. Some transaction has taken place, so the bill of exchange has come into picture. But sometimes a bill is raised even without this type of a transaction. There is no sale or purchase of goods, but a bill of exchange is raised. This is called accommodation bill. Why this accommodation bill is raised by the people? Because a bill of exchange can be discounted with the bank and finance can be obtained on it. It is not necessarily a fraud. It is not illegal. Raising an accommodation bill is not a fraud. Both parties agree with this. A bill is raised without a transaction of goods or services, no transaction has taken place. A bill is raised, accepted, and is presented to the bank for discounting. Bank gives the money on due date it is paid, bank recovers it money. So there is no fraud involved as such, but the fact remains that the money was obtained without any reason, without any genuine requirement. Banks finance only for the reasonable requirements of the business. This was not a reasonable requirement of the business. An accommodation bill was raised and amount was received and was paid on the due date, and in between the credit was enjoyed by the parties. So this is called the accommodation bill. Now, as far as these bills are concerned, every business maintains two types of bill books. In our accounts, we are maintaining two types of subsidiary books. One is the bills receivables book. All the bills which we have drawn and are accepted by our debtors, those are put in this book. These are debited to this book. This will be showing a debit balance, means it's an asset for the company. We have raised a bill, we have to receive the amount from the debtors, and all these bills which are accepted, these are put into this bills receivable book. Similarly, when we are purchasing the goods on credit, somebody has raised a bill on us and we have accepted it. So these bills are credited to bills payable accounts. These two books of accounts are maintained by the business. One is bills receivables book and second is bills payables book.